Hey, church. It's week two from quarantine, and we're doing pretty well here as of the recording of this video. Sad that I can't be with you, but glad that technology makes it possible for me to continue a sermon series for you this morning. The title of this lesson is Gloria, Latin for glory. And it is a reminder of this series that the birth of Christ was expressed through a series of musical numbers in the book of Luke. This is the third, and we're going to be emphasizing the song that is sung by the angels when they serenade the shepherds in the book of Luke. To make sense of a point that I hope becomes apparent in this particular lesson, I need to make a quick side note on two places. The way the Bible talks about two specific places is a little different than we do sometimes, and to make that point is very important to get to what this message is about. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That sets the stage for all the Bible geography you absolutely have to know. I mean, it's great to know where Bethlehem and Jerusalem are, but the big terms in Bible geography are heaven and earth. There's two basic places, and everything in the cosmos can be shifted into one of those two categories. Later, if you want to get technical, you can add Sheol, the place of the dead. But in general terms, throughout the Old Testament and the New, most things that happen in one of two places, heavens or earth. The heavens are just a shorthand for saying the place where God is, where spiritual beings of some sort are. Psalm 115, 16 says, "The heavens are the Lord's heavens, but the earth he has given to the children of man." So the place where God is, that's the heavens or heaven. The earth is the place where humans are. The earth, of course, belongs to the Lord. God created the heavens and the earth, but he has given the earth specifically to us as a place to inhabit. What did we do with that place? Nothing good. You may remember in Genesis chapter 6, just before the flood, "Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence." This place down here where we are, we've made a mess of it. So God will be seen to say things about earth. For example, Isaiah 1 and verse 2, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth. For the Lord has spoken, children have reared and have I reared and brought up, but they have rebelled against me." So he speaks to the heavens and to the earth, and it's the same message. The ones down there on the earth, they've rebelled against me. Second Chronicles chapter 6 and verse 18 mentions this distinction at the building of the temple. In the time of Solomon, the temple is consecrated, was the word I was looking for. Got a little of that COVID brain fog. So if I put Moses on the ark here in a minute or something, just ignore that. The consecration of the temple, the dedication of the temple, Solomon acknowledges the distinction between heaven and earth. "But will God indeed dwell with man on earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heavens cannot contain you, how much less this house that I have built." So the place where God lives is great big and up there, and even it isn't big enough for God. And the place where I live is down here on the earth. And he recognizes, even after building the temple, God can't fit down here where we are, not in the way that I think. And then another place where that's important is in the teaching of Jesus, who prayed, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." That while the creation signifies the two places that God has made, heaven and earth, one for him and one for us. And while at some point they were in harmony, sin and rebellion caused them to be divided and at war with each other in a sense, and one in rebellion against the other, Christ's purpose is that heaven and earth would both unite in doing the will of God, and that there would be harmony again, between the two places in the universe that God has made. So, having said all that, you got a quick tutorial on the terms heaven and earth. When we hear the chorus of the angels to the shepherds, I want us to answer the question, what does Jesus mean for heaven and earth and for the interplay of the two? In Luke chapter 2 and verse 8, it begins the story of the shepherds. It says, "In the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night." The region where they are is down here on the Earth, a very specific place. It's in our world, in the place of Earth where humans live, in a very specific place, not even an important place, the hill country of Judea up and around the hills of Bethlehem and so forth. And out there in the hill country are the hill people, the shepherds. The shepherds, it's not a glorious job. Sheep don't smell particularly nice. They're dirty animals, like most stock animals. They don't worry too much about hygiene like maybe humans do. So I guess we could say it doesn't get much lower than shepherds. If you're looking for people of great significance to encounter in the story of Christ's birth, about as far down the social ladder as you can go would be shepherds, which is why it's surprising them that the people they meet are as far on the opposite end as possible. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. So on the one hand, you have shepherds. It doesn't get much lower than shepherds. And if that's true, we have to notice also it doesn't get much higher than angels, right? These are beings from some other place, from the heavens, beings that come down and the glory of God descends with them. And so you have the majesty of heaven represented by the angels and their host, and then the lowliness and dirtiness of humans on the other hand, represented by the shepherds. This is a story then, the birth of Jesus Christ, that's going to have something to say to both the highest heavens and the lowest regions of earth, the highest inhabitants of heavens and the lowest inhabitants of the earth. Both have some part to play or some consequence in this story. And the angel said to them in verses 10 through 12, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you that you will find a baby wrapped in cloths lying in a manger." First thing we notice then is that Jesus means good news for heaven and earth. And we mean good news in the technical sense. The term good news is where we get our word gospel, euangelion. It's a proclamation of good news. Quite literally in the ancient world, when someone would use this word, it was usually to pronounce the birth of a king or of the victory in some battle. Some formal proclamation was going forth to the entire kingdom. Here goes the tidings. Here goes the good news that's being published abroad. And the angel comes and says, "I've got good news." Good news for everybody, for all the people, everybody. And I believe that we can say that Jesus means good news, means gospel, for both heaven and earth. Not only is this good for us, it's good for heaven, that the angels themselves have an interest. It's not the same interest that we have. They're angels and we're humans, and we're not the same, and we're not the same players in the story. But it's good news for everybody what God is doing in the birth of Jesus Christ. And how do I know that? Because they get very excited. "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest.'" Again, which region does this pertain to? Not the down here, the way up there where God is. The angels are rejoicing and proclaiming the glory of God. In the highest, God is glorified. Jesus means glory in heaven. While we are amazed by the fact that salvation has come to earth, don't ignore the fact that it brings glory to God in heaven. I'm quite convinced that even the angels of heaven look at the gospel unfolding and magnify and worship God on account of it. I think they were shocked and amazed. There's a passage, a little passage in 2 Peter chapter 1 that talks about those things that even the angels would have liked to have looked into. That the prophets of old spoke of what God would do, and even the angels were curious. And now here they are, you know, stooping down to earth to look and to consider. And when they see what God is doing, that there is a child in this manger, in this stable over here at Bethlehem, when they see that, they come and they can't do anything but sing and glorify God, because they recognize great is the God who has done this thing. Jesus means glory in heaven. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. Glory to God in the highest, so glory in heaven, and peace on earth. Why is the peace part important? And why is it signified in earth? There was always peace in heaven. God is at peace in heaven. God created the universe and rested in his heaven. The angels glorify God in his heaven. It's here on earth where we don't have peace. It's here on earth where we've rebelled against our God, where we've declared war on heaven's God, and live with the constant suffering that comes about of that rebellion. Jesus means glory in heaven, but peace on earth. The rebellion can come to an end. The consequences of our sin can be atoned for. And once again, as if for the first time, heaven and earth, man and God, creature and creator, can live in peaceful union. Jesus means peace on earth. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." Why is it that the angels are singing on this occasion? And why is it that the shepherds know something now they didn't before? God has revealed something. In the birth of Jesus Christ, something has been made known that otherwise had been hidden. Jesus means God's glory is made known. God's light is shining down from heaven in the presence of this child, in the person of this human being, Jesus of Nazareth. The glory of God, forever confined to heaven because heaven itself couldn't contain it, and surely not a house that Solomon would build, now will come to rest on this one person. And wherever this person goes, we can behold his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. When we look at the birth of Jesus Christ, it's not just a quaint story. It's a story that represents the union of creature and creation for the good of heaven and earth. God has acted to bring himself glory in heaven and to bring us peace and salvation on earth. I want us to take just a moment and reflect on the fact that the birth of Jesus means more than cute stories. It's cosmic in significance. It's grand in scale. It is the meta-narrative of the entire Bible coming to fruition and beginning its walk to the cross, where even there, in an even more unexpected place, the glory of God can be put on display. Jesus hanging between heaven and earth, suspended there by nails, can make peace between the two. Here once again is another little hymn from church history, a little chant simply known as Gloria, the Canticle of the Angels.
Glory be God.